Cheerful morning to everyone. Myself, Mrs. Anuradha Chandev, principal of Amarpuri Senior Secondary Public School, Goindwal Sahib. Today, I would like to brief all the parents, teachers, and students of my school about the new education policy 2020. As you all know that this new education policy, it was introduced last year in the month of July, and it was approved by the Union Cabinet, which was chaired by our Honorable Prime Minister, Shri Narendra Modi. So, to begin with, I'll start with the history of schooling system that dates back in the year 1805. In those days, the education was designed in such a way as to produce loyal and obedient soldiers, servants and factory workers who would not dare to question the orders of the state or superiors. The orders of the state or superiors would be ultimate. Nobody had the right to express their views. And you can say it was a kind of hierarchy-based structure as followed in the industries or in the factories. And education was based on the need of this industry. Now subjects like math, science were given more importance as compared to humanities and arts. And even art had hierarchy painting, and music was given more preference than the dances and drama. And instead of putting the students together based on their interest or level or learning, they were clubbed according to their age. So that means the interest of the child was not the priority. It was as per the requirements or the needs of the society. So finally, many changes, they came up in the education system throughout the world, and in our country also many changes were there. The earlier policy was designed in the year 1968, then some changes were there in the 1986, followed in 1992. But now this new education policy, 2020, it shares the ideas to revamp education, teaching and assessment system in schools and colleges. Before I proceed further, I just want to say that this new education policy, it is a big change in the field of education. It's with a new vision. Like earlier, the mandatory school education was only considered from 6 to 14 years of age, but now that has expanded. It's from 3 years to 18 years, which includes preschooling also, and there will be more focus on the vocational skills. Rote learning will have no place, more of practical knowledge. And with this policy, of course, I can assure that students will not be like machines. They will be the human beings who are trained according to their interests, according to their needs, so they come out successfully in their careers. And this new education policy has taken into account the curriculums, the syllabus, the textbooks, teacher support material, their learning outcomes, along with the structure of school education, language, higher education, technology, finance and implementation, status of the teacher, along with the implication. All these aspects have been covered up in this new policy of education. Now, to begin with, the biggest change in this is the 10 plus 2 system, which has been divided into 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 format. This 5 years in total, that includes 3 years in pre-primary school, that you even can say the Anganwadis, which are there in the rural setups, 2 years in classes first and second. This is the biggest change, 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4. This will go up to the age of 18 years, starting from 3 years to 18 years of mandatory school education. Presently, the Anganwadi workers are not equipped or trained to teach. That's a problem which comes up in the rural background setups of the schools. The 10 plus 2 pass workers will be trained with a 6 months certificate program. That means, presently the Anganwadi workers, which are not trained for the whatever, how to deal with the young minds, they will be given a training, so they will be better prepared for dealing with the small kids. The 10th pass workers will be trained in a 1-year diploma program. That means right from the beginning, the people who are handling the small kids, 3 to 4 years, 5 years age, they will be in the hands of trained teachers. Coming to the preparatory stage, that will be of 3 years, that is from class 3 to 5. The middle stage, 3 years in total, class 6 to 8. The change which is there in this is that right from the 6th class, vocational programs will be there to develop vocational skills right from class 6th. School exams will be held only for 3 levels, class 3, 5 and 8. Assessment will shift to formative style, which encourages higher order thinking skills, critical thinking, conceptual clarity. So, as I was putting, it is 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4. So, coming to the 4 years, that is classes 9 to 12. Student can opt for courses as per their preference. There is a lot of flexibility in that. And when they are studying, there will be the reviews taken by the peers, that is their group of friends, classmates and teachers. And again, the skills like analysis, critical thinking and conceptual clarity will be taught in the school. So national education policy expands the age group 6 to 14 years of mandatory schooling to 3 to 18 years of schooling. It's a very big landmark. The government has responsibility that this should be mandatory schooling from 3 to 18 years of age. Now going further, that is secondary stage, which I already discussed with you, 4 years. In this, that is classes 9 to 12, the students will allow to take the board exams up to 2 occasions. During any given school year, 1 main examination and 1 for the improvement if desired. And then talking about board exams, they will continue, but then they will not be just seeing the scores of the children, giving them good marks or percentage. They will be framed in a different way. They will be designed for the holistic development of the child. I want to talk about the term PARAKH Parakh, a new national assessment center Parakh. The full form is Performance Assessment Review and Analysis of Knowledge for the Holistic Development will be established. So board exams will have less stakes. Students will not fear the board exams. They will be held in such a manner that they will be giving the exam with full confidence and there will be no rote learning in that. And going further, we continue with this secondary stage. Another aspects which have been introduced, because these are the very crucial years, 9th to 12th. Flexibility in the curriculum. Learners have the ability to choose their learning trajectories and programs and thereby choose their own paths in life according to their talents and interests. No hard separations between arts and science, between curricular and extracurricular activities, between vocational and academic streams, etc. In order to eliminate harmful hierarchies and silos between different areas of learning. So first point, flexibility. No hard and fast rule. The child can opt to choose the subjects of his or her choice. Then no hard separation between arts and science. Then multidisciplinarity and holistic education across the sciences, social sciences, arts, humanities, sports, for a multidisciplinary world in order to ensure the unity and integrity of all knowledge. So these are the highlights of the curriculum that will be between 9th class to 12th class. Now, talking about transforming curricular and pedagogical structure. Now, if we see the existing academic structure, the present one, which is there, that includes 2 years, age 16 to 18, and 10 years, age 6 to 16. That is our 10 plus 2 system. National the new education policy will be stopping that 10 plus 2 system. We will not have that system. That is the old one now. The new academic structure will be 4 years, that is for class 9 to 12, ages 14 to 18 years. Then we go down 3 years, class 6 to 8, age 11 to 14. We go further down 3 years, class 3 to 5, and age 8 to 11. 2 years, class 1 and 2, 6 to 8. 3 years, Anganwadi, preschooling, 3 to 6. So you see, here there was just 2 years and there's a big block of 10 years. And now this has been divided into 4 blocks according to the age groups, according to the mindsets, and many changes in the curriculum. Many changes are there to bring out the best of the child. The new pedagogical and curricular structure of school education, that is 3 years in Anganwadi or preschool and 12 years in the school. Coming to the secondary stage, the multidisciplinary study, which involves the greater critical thinking, flexibility and student choice of subject. It's a very big landmark. Earlier, if a child has opted for science, he has to continue with the science till plus 2, 11th and 12th. So he or she had no choice to change the subjects. But now there is a flexibility. Middle stage, experiential learning in the sciences, mathematics, arts, social sciences and humanities. Preparatory stage, play, discovery, activity-based and interactive classroom learning. Foundational stage, multi-level play, activity-based learning. So if you see the new academic structure and the way the goals have been put forward to achieve, it is really going to bring a very big change in education, and that too towards the positivity, a very well thought, laid out curriculum. Further, if we talk about the new curriculum overhaul, which will be coming, that will be in the shape of a new national curricular framework for school education, which will be undertaken by the NCERT, and all the things which I have discussed, for that the guidelines will be prepared by NCERT, and of course NCERT will be in consultation with the major stakeholders such as SCRT's Board of Assessments, the proposed new National Assessment Center, and teachers prepare for transformation in the assessment system. That means all these bodies will be together working on the assessment system, so it comes out to be a very remarkable assessment system. Then, achieving the universal foundation literacy and numeracy in primary school by 2025. Now, targets, the government has set the target for till 2035. Now, the universal foundational literacy, that means a pupil-teacher ratio of 30:1, one teacher for 30 students will be ensured in each school. Increased focus on the main things, reading, writing, speaking, counting, arithmetic and mathematical thinking. Then national repository of high quality resources will be made available on Diksha app. So you can see that for the primary school by 2025, these are the targets that the teacher student ratio, 1:30, focus on their reading skills, writing skills, speaking, counting. So right from their beginning, their foundation stage will be so grounded, so sound, that it will help them further when they reach the higher classes. Now, the gross enrollment ratio for 2025. Now, when any policy comes up, so the targets are set, that something has to be achieved after a certain span of few years. So the target is that for secondary school, 100%. For secondary school, 100%. That is current 56.5 for 11th and 12th. See how it is just 56.5. But NEP 2020 enrollment says by 2025 we would like to have 100% enrollment. And higher education, which is current very low, 26.3. But now that will be up to 50%. So that means a very good target for attaining the things set up by NEP to be achieved by 2035. Next, coming to the multilingualism and the power of language. Wherever possible, the medium of instruction until at least grade 5, but preferably till grade 8 and beyond, will be the home language or the mother tongue, the local language or the regional language. Because we all know that children till class 5, they will really understand very nicely if things are taught in their mother tongue or the regional language. And thereafter, the home or local language will continue to be taught as a language wherever possible. And this will be followed by both public and private schools. So, there will be introduction of the subject being taught in the regional languages. The three language formula will continue to be implemented while keeping in mind the constitutional provisions, aspirations of the people, regions and the union, and the need to promote multilingualism as well as promote national unity. But there will be a flexibility in the three language formula and no language will be imposed on any state. NEP only recommends the mother tongue as a medium of instruction and not make it compulsory. There will be a flexibility in that depending on the states, and the states will have their right to implement it or not. Then, criticism of primary education in mother tongue. Of course, these things were also there, state versus state, class divide will be further. English is the dominant language of internet, science and technology. And if we talk about, what about children or people in transferable jobs? So when we talked about the regional language or the local language, these were some of the shortcomings. So it is decided, it's up to the state whether to implement it or not. Now, the major reforms in the higher education. So that was 50% gross enrollment ratio by the year 2035. And of course, holistic and multidisciplinary education, flexibility of subjects, multiple entry or exit. If we talk about the UG program, 3 or 4 year. PG program, 1 or 2 year. Integrated 5 year bachelor's or master. There is no MPhil now. MPhil has been discontinued. Credit transfer and academic bank of credits will be there. Then of course, there will be the HEIs, research intensive, teaching intensive universities, and autonomous degree granting the colleges, along with modern multidisciplinary education and research universities. So these are for the higher educations after the school. And talking about the college, there will be a common entrance exam for the admissions. NTA, the National Testing Agency, will conduct the common entrance examination for admission to universities across the country. There will be an aptitude test as well as specialized common subject exam in science, humanities, language, arts, and vocational subjects will be held at least twice every year. So this was for the college. And undergraduation will be either of 3 or 4 years with multiple entry and exit option. Suppose a child takes admission in the college in the first year and then wants to drop, the study will not go wasted. The child will get a certificate. Earlier it was not like that. A child studies for 2 years and then does something else, leaves, he will get an advanced diploma. And if he puts in 3 years, he gets a bachelor's degree. And if he puts in 4 years, a bachelor's degree with research. That means there will be no wastage that a child studied first year, dropped down, he's getting nothing. For every year he's studying, he's getting the acknowledgement, he's getting the certificate, he's getting a degree. And talking about the foreign colleges and universities, according to this NEP, they will be allowed to open campus in our country. And of course, when they will be coming, there will be lot of sharing of knowledge and exchange of ideas and variations. But of course, this did met with some criticism, like promoting private players and foreign universities. Foreign involvement in education, higher education can become grant-based to loan-based. So some shortcomings or some type of criticism was for there, but this is also one of the things that they will be allowed to open campus in the country. Then talking about finance, so NEP, that is the GDP, 6% of GDP. And presently if we see, it is 4.43% of GDP. So there will be increase in the GDP also. So that's also something remarkable. And NEP provides a broad direction and is not mandatory to follow. Since education is a concurrent list subject, the reforms proposed can only be implemented collaboratively by the center and the states. And the government has set a target of 2040 to implement the entire policy. So this is what the government wants, how it wants to implement, and it has put the number of years also for achieving the targets. Going further for the implementation, now free boarding facilities will be built matching the standard of Johar Navodaya Vidyalayas. In school locations where students may have to come from far, and particularly for students who are from socio-economically disadvantaged backgrounds, with suitable arrangements for the safety of all children, especially girls. Kasturba Gandhi Balika Vidyalayas will be strengthened and expanded to increase the participation in quality schools up to grade 12 of girls from socio-economically disadvantaged backgrounds. So that means free boarding facilities like things will also be introduced for the children. Then we have additional Johar Navodaya Vidyalayas and Kendriya Vidyalayas. They will be built around the country. So more KVs will be coming up in India, especially in aspirational districts. Then there will be some special education zones and other disadvantaged areas to increase high quality educational opportunities. Preschool sections covering at least 1 year of early childhood care and education will be added to Kendriya Vidyalayas and other primary schools around the nation, particularly in disadvantaged areas. So this will really help out the children belonging in the remote areas. It will really bring up the education in these areas. Then ensuring the inclusion and equal participation of children with disabilities in ECCE. That ECCE is your early childhood and children education, and the schooling system will be awarded the highest priority. Children with disabilities will be unable to fully participate in the regular schooling process from the foundational stage to higher education. The Right of Person with Disabilities Act 2016 defines inclusive education as a system of education where students with and without disability learn together, and the system of teaching and learning is suitably adapted to meet the learning needs of different types of students with disabilities. This is something very great. If a child is having some special needs, or a child is disabled, but that child also has the right to study with the normal children. So that means there is no lack of confidence in that child. No doubt the teaching processes will be as per the needs of the child, but all the children will be studying together. This policy is complete consonance with the provisions of the RPWD, that is the Right of Person with Disability Act 2016, and endorses all its recommendations with regard to school education. While preparing the national curriculum framework, NCERT will ensure that consultations are held with expert bodies such as National Institutes of DEPWD, that is Department of Empowerment of Person with Disability. So that means special care of the children needs who are having some disabilities is taken into account in this NEP. And now, last but not the least, I just want to say that this NEP is a remarkable change in the field of education. Even the foreign countries are appreciating this NEP 2020. And but to make any program education policy successful, a lot of role the teacher has to play. So in this, even the teachers will not be transferred, their transfers will not be after every 2 years or 3 years. Stability will be there, and teachers will be given more facilities so they do justice with the children. The more will be academic work given to the teacher will be more as compared to the other works which have been earlier been given to the teachers. They will be teaching with all the things, with all the proper equipments and teaching aids they have. So lot of things are there for the teacher also. And in the last, I just want to say that we really welcome this new education policy, and I am very confident that it will really bring remarkable changes, and its results will be very visible and positive after 5 years. And of course, everybody would accept it wholeheartedly. Of course, when any change comes, that some people resist, some people are apprehensive, but change is the law of nature, and every new change brings new ideas and new visions. So that's all I have to say, and thank you so much, and God bless you all.